Good afternoon and welcome. Yeah, don't fall in.
It's better to take a little dive in our pond.
We should do it, it's definitely warm enough. Look, welcome to this pre-opera talk. My name is Sarah Moore-Peach. I'm a Radio 3 presenter. And indeed, Radio 3's made its first ever visit to Garsington this year. We've recorded Semele, which will be broadcast on the 1st of July. And I'm also on the advisory committee of Garsington and a great friend of the company. And I just think what they do is completely extraordinary and in a way like what no other company is doing in quite the same way. Artistically very bold, and also what an amazing place and experience it is. So I'm delighted to be here with director Michael Boyle and conductor Jacques van Steen to talk about tonight's performance of Pelléas. And Jacques, I'd like to start with you because I read that you've had your score of Pelléas since you were 18 years old, since your 18th birthday. Is it actually the one that you have here?
It is actually the one I have here. And in the meantime, of course, I got two new ones, only two, for this lovely work. And I don't know why I brought it now, because I need it in a few hours. But this is the very one, and it's full, you can't see it, but it's like a painting. It's not only an oral painting, but a visual painting for me as well.
Who gave it to you?
It was my first 18th birthday present from my parents.
Wow, and had you specifically requested it?
Well, I think I asked for it, because obviously as a student you can't afford anything big like Debussy. So I asked for it as the start of perhaps something that has to do with waving your arms and what we now call conducting.
And why did you want that opera? I mean, I know it's one that you've really loved and felt enormously close to since then. What caught your attention
about it? The direct reason is a very simple one. As you have, and I still have, I mean, I saw a concert with the Philharmonia that you will hear tonight in the pit with Herbert Blomstedt and Beethoven's 7th Symphony, and he was my hero when I was 18, and my teacher was my hero, and my teacher was a Francophile. He was absolutely into French music, spoke fluently French, was a friend of Francis Poulenc, and he made me warm for the French landscape of Ravel and Debussy. That's how it came.
Michael, how about you? What was your first encounter with Pelléas? Is it a work that you've known for a long time, or is it quite a new encounter?
No, it's completely new. I knew...
Speaking to Michael.
I'd read Maeterlinck's play, I think, when I was a student. The opera was new to me when Garsington first started talking to me about doing it about 4 or 5 years ago. And my first experience was somebody else's CD, the former artistic director of Garsington's favourite CD, and it immediately started getting under my bloodstream. But listening to Jacques there reminds me, I'm working on a translation of a piece that was written the same year as this was first performed, Chekhov's Cherry Orchard. Which was written in 1903, when this, I think, was first performed. And I'm working from the text that I did my A-level Russian with. And it's important, the magic of the original inspiration. I completely sympathise with that.
I wish we knew when we were 18 that the books we had and the works that we encountered would end up somehow as a blueprint for the rest of our lives.
I think we did, that's why we kept them.
So what is it, when you say it gets into your bloodstream or under your skin, what is it about Pelléas that does that? Because there are operas that absolutely capture the imagination or get our hearts or somehow, yes, stimulate us. And then there's a piece like Pelléas that, when people talk about it, is always in this slightly insidious, slightly strange way that it grabs you, that it somehow... intoxicates you?
Oddly, and I think it can work both ways with people on first encountering the opera, probably. Oddly, it refuses to clearly and obviously define its own shape. that it refuses to settle on a sustained melody except about maybe three times in the whole opera. And so it's a shifting shape of a beast. And therefore, it remains constantly open to you in a funny way, because it's not, oh, I know what that is, and you put it over there, and you can sort of almost distance yourself from it, even pleasurably. This, the pleasure is not from distancing yourself from it and knowing what it is, being able to name it. It's diving in and swimming.
And does that make it an easier opera to work with as a director, or a more challenging one because there's so much openness? I mean, that could be terrifically exciting because you get to take it in a way, in whatever direction you want. At the same time, it's slippery.
I think for everyone involved, it allows you to identify subjectively with each of its moments, and it makes it harder, I think consciously on the part of both Maeterlinck and Debussy, harder to define what the whole thing is, what it's about. And I don't think that's a bad thing in art, actually. I think to have vivid colours and not to be absolutely certain what the thing must be is, it's like looking at a painting. And you don't, when you look at a painting, go, oh, this is about this, that, and the other. You stand patiently until it comes to you. And I think that's how this opera works.
And Jack, does that also apply from your perspective to how it works musically? I mean, Michael partly talked about this constantly shifting melodic landscape, that it doesn't settle in one place.
It might sound silly, but it is completely the opposite, which still is a challenge to work together. The score gives me, every bar, a lead how to feel, how the psychology of the main characters will sound, how the singers have to act, how the pacing of the pieces. There's a famous line that I would love to repeat, is that Debussy wrote as if he was his own director for the opera. So it's all there. And what might be, I mean, I'm hardly talk about how Michael and I work together, but if you say the last 25 days, Michael, I think, with one day rest in the week, starting the morning, 10:30, with at least 45 minutes of just music, singers, myself, piano, then Michael, at least 45 minutes, that scene that we just musically sort of performed for Michael, going deep in the text, translating, finding possible ways of looking at it, the impact of the singers on the text, what they think, and then it's about time for a break, and we didn't do one thing that Michael sort of in work in progress makes in the scene. And at first I thought, oh my dear, every day this process, and it worked incredibly well. Music, inspiration, text, interval, and then start working on the set. And that was our journey the last 4 weeks.
So did you already at the beginning of the rehearsal process know that that was how you were going to work, or did that emerge because the piece demanded it?
I think we found it was the first time Jack and I had worked together, and I think we just
did it.
We sat together and found our way together. Yeah.
What is a joy for a conductor, as you can imagine, I work with a lot of directors, and it is a joy for a conductor that you have a director who has an ear for the music, and I don't mean literally that he has perfect pitch or knows the singing roles, but I have directors who can do that. I once offered my baton to the director and said, now you conduct, you're so good. But that's not necessary to be a good director. What is good is that Michael was always open for suggestions. And we must not forget that the most valuable time for two of us was long time ago. I can't even remember. I think at least 6-7 months. First a day at Michael's place to feel comfortable, get to know each other, and then 3 days in my place in Holland, just from 8 o'clock in the morning after breakfast till 8 o'clock in the evening, talking about the piece and mentioning the things that we want to make relevant for it. And that was very valuable for us.
And so in those early conversations, what were the things that really came out about what you wanted to say about the piece, Michael?
I suppose I shared early on some of the smell of the world that Debussy and Maeterlinck were writing in. A world very much a millennial turn of the century world, a world of some anxiety. 2 years before the first of the Russian revolutions, not long before the Great War, a sense of a great Victorian age, a great huge advances in the 19th century, which nonetheless had left people dissatisfied in all sorts of ways that led, for instance, to the symbolist movement, who felt that mere representation wasn't enough. Great advances in film and photography, but it didn't seem to be getting us any nearer to being able to describe what life felt like at the end of the 19th century, beginning of the great modern 20th century. So this appetite for something more impressionist that could do things that mere recording photography, for instance, couldn't do. Something that regained poetry. Something that in the case of this looked to the past for a new inspiration. And the world that's described in the text is one that is at war. And it's a world full of hate. The kingdom of Allemande is at war and in conflict with other places, and that's what the marriage that wasn't to Mélisande was supposed to be all about for Golo, and Golo got interrupted and married Mélisande, the crazy girl by the pond, instead. But Arkel's plan for Allemande, which sounds quite like Germany, was to make peace. Arkel wanted to make peace, the peacemaker. It's a world that is dominated by illness. It is an old, it's an aging world. And it's a world where nearly all the young people die. Mélisande and Pelléas, the youngest leads, perish. They're Arkel announces Mélisande as the beginning of a renewal, almost as though she's Proserpina come up from Hades to create spring in Allemande. But she has to be sacrificed as part of that ritual process, maybe. The young in the old, the contrast between old and young did interest me a great deal, and I shared that with Jean, that it seemed to be that the young suffered at the hand of the old in the piece, and certainly Golo did not do right by his son by making him spy upon his new wife and his brother. So I saw a lot of damage to the young, and I saw the old wanting, knowing that they needed reviving, and perhaps slightly exploiting the young in order to try to do so.
And what you describe, particularly at the start of what you were saying about the setting of it, where we are, I mean, we'll talk in a moment about where we actually are in the set, but strikes me that it's actually a rather apt work for right now. I mean, we are at the beginning of another century in shaking times.
It rang bells with both of us, the anxiety of our times, and the sense that a lot of great certainties that we have lived with maybe for the last 30, 40 years are being seriously challenged all over the world. And there is that same sense of something new must happen. We're aware of a famine in the land in our own way, just as there is in Allemande, and strife. And we don't have all the answers. And Pelléas and Mélisande is not an effort to find out those answers, but it's an effort to express amongst other things, what it feels like to live in that world. It's not an attempt to solve it.
So, I mean, to kind of to set the scene of that world, because Debussy creates such an incredibly strong sense of atmosphere and place. Jacques, how does he do that in this score? I mean, how does what we hear tell us about where we are and what it feels like to be in Allemande at that moment?
First of all, I think, Sarah, I should say that there was nothing written like the Pelléas and Mélisande score before Debussy started it. And nobody could or wanted to copy it. So it's so if we have the universe, it's on a planet, it's there, and it came to us. We must also not forget that he spent 12 years, perhaps longer, because it might sort of started when he was a young man. He worked 12 years on it. So he could, like you make a diamond, you can refine it. And every month there was another impulse for his music. In contrast to a fantastic performance yesterday I heard with the artistic director of the company, Douglas Boyd, in Nozze di Figaro, that I told one of the colleagues when I walked outside after the performance, I said, mind you, Mozart wrote it in a shorter time than you rehearsed it, in terms of 3 weeks, and then the Nozze di Figaro was ready. In Debussy land, it's not the issue. It is a process, a journey that Debussy and I am convinced that there is not one opera not autobiographic. I think there is Debussy's experience, Debussy's personality, Debussy's difficult personality. Now, to come a little bit more direct to an answer of your question, how do you hear that? Debussy being an enormous, in his youth, Wagner fan, and then not the Wagner of Rienzi, the early ones, or even Flying Dutchman, which of course I must love being Dutch, but the Parsifal Wagner, so where time and space become one, meaning that leitmotif, I don't know the English word, but having a theme for a character, for a protagonist in the story, it is not literally so strong as in Richard Wagner's music, but there is a Mélisande tune, there is a Pelléas harmony, there is an orchestration. If Golot comes on stage and Arkel, so the elder generation, the darker generation, so to speak, then there are trombones in the orchestra. And the extraordinary thing in orchestrating this work is that if I count, and I did, because you want to not to please an orchestra, but you don't want to be in a way in the rehearsal that you think you have to sit 3.5 hours and then play 2 bars and then go home. That's in this time, in 2017, not economical. But I asked them all to stay in the rehearsal, and the trombones play perhaps from the 2.5 hours of music, 6 minutes in total. And it didn't matter. They were so like a biology of the score was so in their system as well, and they just sat in back of the orchestra and enjoyed what we were doing on the way getting there, where they have to play when Golot or Arkel goes in. The woodwinds, which you will feel positioned at the side of the pit, they have an enormous personal life. So an oboe is always connected with the tears of Mélisande. And that painting of the sound in the woodwinds, in the brass, in the string orchestra, and of course the vehement music, the really attacky music where there are fights on stage, that is the whole orchestra. And as I worked a few times with the Philharmonia this season before we started looking into Pelléas, there was a buzz of, we are coming to Garsington. We are coming to perform Pelléas at Garsington Opera. So the orchestra is thrilled to bring their expertise in the score, as they know the score very well, to bring that to this opera house, which was an enormous privilege and an experience.
And it's also incredibly exciting to have the Philharmonia here at the start of their partnership with Garsington, 5-year partnership, and this is the very beginning of it, so it's very exciting to see how that develops. So Michael, tell us about where we are actually sitting. I mean, in the middle of Tom Piper's set, I remember coming to your early model showing of the set, so it's always an enormous thrill to see it realised. Tell us a bit about the sort of thinking behind it and where in the world the inspiration comes from.
In one sense, it's a response by Tom and I to the the tradition or structure in opera. Well, certainly I'm still a baby to opera, this is only my third opera. And I'm not used to the way opera organises things with designs almost a year in advance. In fact, in my time as artistic director at the RSC, I managed to persuade the workshops to allow us not to sign off designs until halfway through rehearsals. Because I felt that the concrete environment needed to correspond with what was happening between the human beings. Accepting that that can't be the case in opera, we wanted to create a world that caught the spirit but didn't nail any one scene. At the model showing we didn't go, and then on measure 38 someone enters upstage left and comes through here and something flies in from there. We wanted to create a universe that allowed us a flexibility working with Jacques and the repetiteur, Edwige in the rehearsal room and the singers, just to see to some extent where it would take us. It's a flexible world that gives us all that we needed. We needed two fountains, the blind man's fountain and the fountain in the forest, which we have consciously made one. One echoes the other very much in this production. We gave ourselves the grandeur of Allemande. I didn't want Arkel to be some sort of cute fairy tale medieval powerless king. He's a real king. He's a powerful man, even though he's on the edge of mortality. It gives us the world is so in famine, facing mortality, all those things in the opera, that it is being invaded by nature, and so it also, with the help of some girders, does service for the forest as well. So nature invading the world, the beautiful, it goes from ugliness and death to great beauty, which is what we were after, a kind of melancholy, exquisite, paradoxical beauty that we felt was in the opera.
And as you were working on a set with Tom, I know that a lot of the inspiration you're taking was from derelict buildings in America, in Detroit, sort of totally run down.
Well, when we were thinking of worlds, of once great worlds, I had bumped into, I was taken to an old theatre in Detroit, which of course was really the richest city in America, now famously a city of great decay. And friends of mine said, you've got to see this place, it's a car park in downtown Detroit. And it used to be the Majestic Theatre, and there were three slabs of concrete with ramps in between, inserted into this great Edwardian era theatre. That had literally, nobody wanted to spend a single cent on this conversion into a car park. And the decay was such, and the extraordinary preservation was such, that even the old theatrical curtain was half hanging off the rail on the proscenium arch of the theatre. And it had stuck in my mind, and when I was trying to think of an image for Allemande, in such danger of, in such decay and facing death, and yet so beautiful and inspiring as well. That was a place that Tom and I went to, and we found a book full of extraordinary buildings in Detroit that with mushrooms and grass. Tom started adapting his own beautiful version of it.
Jack, I want to come back to something that you mentioned earlier when you were talking about Wagner, and kind of ask about the connection between Tristan and Isolde, Wagner's opera, and Pelléas. There are lots of parallels, and in many ways they're often considered when people are sort of looking at that sort of operatic world of the late 19th, early 20th century, considered two sides of a similar coin. There is the love triangle, and also somehow a kind of an obsession with and a questioning around darkness and light thematically.
That gave me the inspiration, and not only that, but also the fact that I sort of 10 years of my career, my opera career started in Weimar. Who was conducting there? Richard Strauss. Who was conducting there? Franz Liszt. Franz Liszt conducting Lohengrin. So that environment you can't ignore as a conductor. You can't ignore what you absorb as a young man to learn from the tradition. And I know my Weimar orchestra, there was of course no one still playing in the orchestra, but the as I hear in the Philharmonia, my colleagues, my big examples, Klempler and Karajan, they were all here. Somehow it is in the genes of the orchestra, and that convinced me to treat Debussy's Pelléas and Mélisande as a reflection of Tristan and Isolde in the sound scape I tried to achieve with the orchestra. And that is not something you put into words. You don't go to the orchestra and you lecture them. You only have two rehearsals for 2.5 hours of music, and you start at the beginning of the rehearsal, and you, by gestures, by your body language, you translate what you hear. I hear music, obviously, in myself, otherwise I wouldn't be a conductor. But they have to transport that music to you, to the audience. And that will be what you hopefully experience with me, this journey of a Tristan and Isolde flavor in the Pelléas and Mélisande, without losing the French perfume of it, because it's obviously, it is not an English score and it's not a Dutch score, but if anything, it's a combination of those two worlds that I want to try to bring alive.
As someone relatively new to operas, one of my favourite things is that extra player in what's happening of an evening. Obviously, I already know that the play doesn't, or the opera doesn't happen here, it happens in the space between the performers here and you there, and what's happening in the space in between. And it's quite wonderful that in opera there is this extra character, the conductor, who is this kind of conjurer in the middle of it, who is both responding to and provoking what's happening on stage, in the orchestra, and is the person who's closest to the audience as well. And it's a lovely new triangulation of electricity in the evening that opera has, that as a theatre director I really adore watching.
There is not a parallel that you will experience that we decided in the very end to give you an opportunity to listen to, as the change of sets in the Paris performance in the premiere was so complicated. People asked Debussy to write like it happens. I mean, Balanchine worked with Stravinsky and he needed four more bars to jump a bit higher with his dancers. Stravinsky just simply in 1 minute wrote four excellent bars in his ballet. In this case, Debussy wrote interludes between the scenes of the most beautiful, either already predicting what's going to happen or reflecting on music and on scenes that just have been played. And that symphonic element is, of course, for a conductor, it is not a Donizetti opera where everything happens on stage and you just try to accompany with the best tempi. That would not personally be my repertoire. But this symphonic landscape element in an opera, that is also the parallel with Tristan and Isolde or with Parsifal, and in this case with Pelléas and Mélisande, that you will hopefully experience tonight.
And I think that speaks to the desire, to the ambition in both Maeterlinck and his literary contemporaries, and Debussy and his both musical and visual arts contemporaries, to access the unconscious, the unsaid, that which cannot be literally said between characters. It is the world of emotion, feeling, that is inexpressible in anything other than music. And I hope we give that room to breathe in this production.
Just before I give you a chance to ask some questions, Michael, I just wanted to pick up on this issue of darkness and light being such an important theme, I suppose, in the opera, it, particularly in the way that it sort of moves from this incredible darkness into this, you know, sort of the light coming through, partly with the new child of Mélisande, etc. And to point out the obvious, which is that we are sitting in an opera house which is full of light. It's full of natural light, and it will, throughout the course of the evening, become darker and darker. How did you deal with that challenge?
Well, as an opera, it moves from dark to light and back to dark. And in the penultimate scene, where the lovers meet, one of the main lovely arguments they have between them is, come and be in the dark. No, I want to be in the light. And then they reverse positions on it. It is a very important thing. And I think the presence of God's light in this auditorium is a real blessing for this opera. Tom and I have done our best to moderate God on stage. In that we wouldn't normally, it's very unlike us as a partnership to close off what a building gives you on stage. But on this occasion we decided we would kill direct sunlight across the stage so that we can to some extent control the gloom of Allemande, even in the first part before the interval tonight. After the interval, it is almost as dark. It's not entirely dark, but everyone feels the encroaching gloom. And then, with the help of some lovely, very powerful, quite old-fashioned light, we play God with light, and we make it light again. I think the main thing is that the presence of actual light makes us, the audience, more acutely aware of the absence of it when it comes.
So, if anyone out here in the audience has any questions, either for God or for the conjurer, please raise your hand and I'll repeat the question back so that everyone can hear it. Yes, gentlemen in the front row. So is there an inevitability to what unfolds in the opera in the sense that everything is sort of on a spool that happens again and again and again?
The cyclical, our cycle is hinted at the end with Mélisande pitying her daughter and predicting that she will cry. There's no specific evidence in either the text or I think the music that this has all happened precisely before, that literally we're in a time loop. Although time is played with strangely in the music, certainly. Arkell talks very effectively about destiny and feels that he, at his great age, has come to the awakening, and he says, this is perhaps the greatest enlightenment that I've had with my great age, is that there are no events that are without a purpose. So he has his finger on the pulse to some extent. Another sense of repetition that is in the text, potentially, it's there, but I think it's ambiguous, and I think it's probably meant to be ambiguous, is Mélisande has come from, clearly, a marriage with a round object, which is a crown, which goes into the water, and then she marries again, and there's another round object, which again ends up in the water. So there is a kind of repeated pattern there, but I'm not sure that we're instructed to think it is identical. if you do I don't think anything is meant to be predictable. I think there is tension and suspense in the piece, which if things were absolutely certain to be repeated in exactly the same way, I think that would make a mockery of Arkell's hope, and I think it would perhaps make the evening slightly less suspenseful. But the idea of the cycle is suggested, I agree.
Jacques, is there inevitability in the score as well?
In the score, Debussy makes the score end, if that's the right English, so he stops the score. And I'm very into tonalities. It's too sort of musically detailed, even in a Mozart opera. If you listen to Nozze di Figaro and there is only one scene, beginning of Act 4, where Barbarina has lost her maschina, her hairpin, and that metaphor for losing more than only her hairpin. That's the only 3 minutes of music in F minor. To come back to, that's for me a very important key point in this score, a dark key. In Debussy, we start in the darkest sort of dungeon of D minor, then over all kinds of tonalities related to the protagonist, we end in the brightest C sharp major in just flutes and string orchestra, ethereal somewhere there as going to another space. That is not without reason, that the psychology of the tonalities work unconscious in your system. And that's an interesting thing, how Debussy makes the journey from one key into the furthest away on the circle, the furthest away tonality up in the universe, in C sharp major. You will hear me sort of not stop the piece, because this orchestra can hold bars and bars and bars in one breath, this pianissimo going up. You will enjoy that very last moment, because I don't stop, I let the music stop. And that's magic. If I come to think of it, I'm looking forward to start already.
Another question.
That was such a good question, you've intimidated everyone else.
So I'm curious.
The story, a bit of a synopsis.
Ah, the synopsis. Well, but the question was, actually it wasn't a question, but it was just to say that for those of us who haven't seen the opera before and don't know it, it's a little hard to know what's happening because we haven't actually talked about the synopsis. But I think it's an interesting one because what you were saying at the beginning, that it does not, it's not particularly clear. I mean, things happen, but there's a mystery to the way that this opera unfolds, which is...
A girl at the beginning has come from being mightily abused. It clearly has something to do with her marriage, but there are lots of people involved who have mightily abused her. She is by a fountain weeping. She has clearly, she has dropped or thrown or submerged her crown. She's a princess in the pond. And she is found by the heir to the throne of Allemande, who, like our own heir to the throne, has waited really rather too long, and is himself grey-haired and quite senior. He is supposed to be marrying, making a political marriage to someone else, but his feelings of... He is attracted to this girl by the pond, his feelings of protectiveness, whatever. He rescues her from her perilous situation and takes her away. We later find out that he then marries her. And you could say that from then things maybe do become a bit inevitable, because she seeks his protection. He is deeply in love with her. He might be another abuser like the man before, but he didn't show any signs of that whatsoever in the first scene. She is brought back to Allemande, she is accepted in the court. She meets the younger brother of the heir to the throne, and they fall in love. And a beautifully modulated and agonizing triangle emerges and is twisted and is drawn out in the opera, and eventually it becomes unsustainable for the heir to the throne, and he finds them kissing, and he attacks them. That's the briefest of synopses.
The baritone is in love with the soprano, and the tenor wants the soprano. That's in short. That is all about. We don't have a tenor because we looked in our audition phase, which is pretty much months before you actually hear us, and a process that Michael and I and the whole team of Garsington Opera work on this aspect very, very deeply. We found Debussy's ideal voice type, which is hardly explicable. It's not a tenor and it's not a baritone. And in Debussy's era, there was a very famous baritone. A baritone Martin is the definition of it, which is a high baritone with the tessitura of a tenor, but also with the depth of a baritone. And in Jonathan McGovern, we have found this type of voice for us and for you that is Debussy's ideal. And as we want to come as close to the score in interpretation, this is one part of it.
We are going to have to leave it there, sadly, to give both of you time, Jacques, to take time to prepare and to clear the stage. But please join me in thanking Jacques Van Steen and Michael.